So today I plan to give a lecture on on advances and challenges. And challenges of atmospheric quality modeling and forecasting. This lecture we prepared together with a colleague of my Professor Yan Zhang from Northeast University in the United States, Boston. And of course, I would like to say first of all that this lecture, as well as our school, is a tribute and memories to Professor Sergei Zilitinkevich and outstanding scientist and teacher and my close friend, and really his contribution to issues what I will present is really great and in general in atmospheric science. What about the topic what I would like to consider now? First of all, I proceed what you know the main processes for atmospheric pollution issues from your university courses, so I will not say about main equations and main processes. Just to put more focus on some advances in modeling of air quality and forecasting processes. First of all, moving to ensemble of state of the art models and high resolution emission inventories, space observations, surface measurements, which are needed for providing hindcast analysis and forecast from global to regional air pollution and to downscaling to selected countries or urban areas. And of course, the importance of such studies and interest to research and investigation of atmospheric composition and its modeling for different type of applications is now substantially increasing. Also, air quality forecast required more and more, not only for local scale, but also for regional and global, and not only for health impact as usually considered, but also for different applications, for example, impact on agriculture, ecosystems, climate, and many other applications, for example, energy, etc. And also, we have to consider what just recently the World Health Organization published a new air quality guidelines, which increase very much requirements for quality of atmosphere pollution substantially, and we need to proceed from the new requirements. That is definitely also put more efforts for air quality modeling and analysis of different aspects. And also these requirements of WHO consider not only long-term impact on health of atmospheric pollution, but also peak episodes of pollution where forecasting is absolutely necessary. So this lecture is based not only on my and Yan Zhan own research, but also we analyze some recent published overview and also very much using WMO Global Atmosphere Watch experience of the World Meteorological Organization where I'm working. So the main trends what we see during last decades in development of modern atmospheric composition modeling and air quality forecasting system. First of all, it is seamless prediction of the Earth system approach. This one of the main trends, and also moving to online coupling of atmospheric dynamic and chemistry models. And of course, multi-scale prediction approach, emission modeling for improved emission data, data fusion, machine learning methods, and bias correction techniques, multi-platform observation and data simulation, and also very important, as I see also in previous lecture, it was mentioned about ensemble approach of different models and parameters, and also moving from short-term forecast to sub-seasonal and seasonal forecast. And a very important point, for fit for purpose approach, I'll say about that a bit later, and also impact-based forecast. And of course, capacity building, training, education aspects are important in our activities, and this is one of the purpose for the BMO and university system. So, stimulus prediction system, what I mentioned. Several dimensions in seamless coupling and integration, and we can see there, first of all, time scales from seconds to now casting to decadal and long-term time scales, and also special scales from street level to regional and global, and processes with different physical, chemical, biological, and of course also system compounds, and also different types of observation and modeling, and also linked to end users and requirements for decision makers. But I will not go into details to this topic. Modeling of atmospheric dynamic and chemistry, because tomorrow I'll have a specific lecture for this seamless integrated modeling approach, and where we'll consider this new generation of seamless integrated meteorology and chemistry modeling systems within this Earth system modeling approach. What is important in this lecture to consider, what when we are talking about atmospheric pollution, we have to consider many processes, not only dynamic of pollutants, but the interaction with atmospheric processes within this seamless approach, because not only meteorology impacted to atmospheric pollution, transport, dispersion, and chemical transformation or deposition, but also atmospheric pollution impact on meteorological processes. And below you can see several chains, chain where, for example, temperature is impacted chemistry, photochemistry, for example, changing concentration, and concentration impact on radiative properties, and radiation correspondingly impact on temperature. So we can have a chain of processes which are important to consider together, and many other chains, tomorrow we'll say a bit more about that, are important. So this way where modern models more and more linked with atmospheric processes, not one way, but at least two way nesting, integration, sorry. Second or third direction, what we would like to consider as one of the advantages in atmospheric pollution modeling is moving from one scale to multi-scale prediction approach. And also monitoring, analysis, and forecasting systems should operate at different scales, from global scale to regional and national and urban, and also suburban, sometimes on street scale we need to provide assessment and forecast. So for this purpose, is zooming and special nesting grid technique usually used, and in different models, in Wolf Chambers, which is quite common around the world, and Cosmo Art, what Russia is used, and also EnviroHilo model, what our team developed. Usually used one-way nesting and this downscaling when values of modeling variables at coarse resolution are used as boundary conditions for finer subscale resolution runs than for Ullmann's scale. But in some cases, impact of local areas and local processes also give some feedback on larger scale. And in this case, we need to consider also two-way nesting when information from a high resolution scale is in addition transmitted across the boundaries to the coarse resolution. Sorry. And this approach is also quite actively now developing. But of course, this way is more expensive because you need to readjust forecasting or assessment from one scale to other. And street level quality is downscaling with microscale use another type of models, and for example, stake resolve models and using computational fluid dynamic types of models or using different type of parameterizations. I suppose in specific lectures for urban modeling will be considered more in detail, so I just briefly touched that. So, and again, this seamless unified approach leads to a new type of platforms for a cross-scale modeling, what we call one atmosphere models, and this single platform give a lot of advantages in both for science and also efficiency modeling for different scales. And there are several modeling systems which are actively developed, in particular in the United States. This MUSICA and MPSA modeling system. And many are actually other now also Cosmo is moving to such a platform community. And major challenges, of course, in this approach includes also globalization and downscaling with consistency of modeling physics and also two-way nesting to keep mass conservation and consistency. And this is still a challenging problem, and not all aspects are well resolved and enough sufficient. But this unify global to urban scale modeling provides new scientific capability and of course one of the main direction and also a good area for research and for students. I would really recommend to move to this type of future developments and considering your future research. Some example of such multi-scale modeling tools, in particular two projects, European Union projects, what considered Citizen and Megapoli, what I was coordinating that. And there we suggested such multi-scale modeling with seamless approach from global to regional. Below you can see an example of such two and one-way nesting on example of Denmark and Copenhagen area from global to regional and country scale and city scale and up to street scale But of course, it is more for research or for specific street canyons, but quite expensive to do it on such scale for full city. But another example is actively realized under WMO GURMA project and mostly by our Indian colleagues. Safar integrated system for air quality forecasting is downscaling from regional city scale, and it was realized first for New Delhi, and now it's realized for five largest cities in India, and downscaling going from 45 kilometers for global scale and for 1.5 kilometers, 167 kilometers for city scale. Another example what Alexander Mahura developed is application of EnviroHillam and Harmony modeling for Chinese cities, and it is an example of how downscaling with EnviroHillam work for Shanghai urban areas is downscaling to 2.5 kilometers. And also for Copenhagen, we tested a way with downscaling to street scale, also using a CFD type of models with resolving of individual buildings structure. And here you can see it's recently published by Roman Nutterman and co-authors in ACP journal, improvement of a forecast of air quality for specific street canyon, a most polluted street in Copenhagen, where else we have good measurements, and improvement of street scale pollution only when we are resolving structure of buildings and provide much more careful forecast on street level where actually people are breathing, and of course we have to care about environment on that level. But of course for forecasting, it is quite expensive way, and there are also many approaches. But however, first, modern supercomputers provide now enough capacity to arrange forecasting for real time with such approach. And in the MAC project, what here is demonstrated, it was demonstrated for several cities and could be in future used. So it's also one of the direction for future research. Another extremely important area of improvements of atmospheric pollution models, it's emissions. And what is the important trend, what we are moving more and more from emission inventories with fixed emissions for example, annual emissions or with adjustment to monthly variation, to emission modeling, especially for emissions of meteorology dependent pollutants or chemical compounds. And now in many cases, additionally to inventories for anthropogenic emissions, or the natural emissions are considered. And of course they have to be correctly modeling within models. Such example are, for example, pollen forecasting, because allergens and pollen particles are, of course, depend on meteorological conditions, and also biogenic emissions are meteorology dependent, dust storms forecasting, biomass burning, and also wildfires, smoke pollution. And for these purposes, specific methods for parameterization of emissions are developed, and in modern forecasting systems they are implemented and improve models substantially. Here you can see some example of such improvements, for example, for burning emissions. And of course, when we are talking about emission control, we have to proceed from, especially when we are considering in general sustainable development goals, we have to care not only about health impact and environment, but also on climate impact and co-benefits for environment and climate. And here, we can have not always win-win situations. For example, impact on health and climate could be in different directions, and this balance is very important, and especially for economical impact of effectiveness of different measures to reduce emissions, where to put main efforts to get maximum effects and also co-benefits for environment and climate. Other direction for improvement of models, especially last maybe 5-10 years, it's a huge number of papers published. It's a method of data fusion and machine learning methods, and of course more common and classical bias correction techniques. And these very important issues, but provide a good way to improve air quality forecasting models. But what I would like to stress, what sometimes, especially for machine learning and new artificial intelligent neural network methods, starts suggesting as a kind of new type of models instead of main air quality forecasting and more atmospheric chemical transport deterministic models. I have to say what not always it is possible to provide only by such machine learning methods forecast, because physical processes and chemical mechanisms have to be included, and combination of deterministic methods with machine learning and bias correction technique, and also data fusion for example, for assessments are the most efficient way. And also why importance of new types of data fusion and machine learning methods became more and more important, because observations now provide much more observation and monitoring data, and sometimes in different formats and different types and different quality of data. And we need to learn how to work with such new data and how to use in models. And classical data simulation methods not always suitable for these purposes. And we need to work with other type of artificial intelligence and neural network and machine learning methods to have better performance. And as I mentioned, hybrid and combined methods have better quality, and such methods are improvement. And of course, advanced bias correction methods are also important, and like Kalman filter and also improved Kolmogorov-Zorbenko filter technique, which are quite common, used in modern models. And returning to observations, as I mentioned, multi-platform observations and data simulation, one of the key element of a modern air quality forecasting system. And of course, observations now provided, as mentioned, it different type of measurement sources is surface networks and also upper air measurements, soundings methods, aircraft measurements, and of course satellite based observation, and also more and more now is it what we call crowdsourcing data and citizen science, let's call it, from citizens, different type of observation with mobiles, phone, and etc. And of course, for these purposes, data simulation methods are also improving, and also important to simulate not only meteorological parameters, but also chemical data simulation, and using inverse modeling for adjustment of emission sources information. So this, and as I know what it will be a special lecture for data simulation, so I will not go into details, just would like to stress what multi-platform observation are considered several levels. First of all, multi-purpose for forecast or for research or for long-term planning and mitigation services. Approaches are different, and also for multi-function from high impact weather and air quality and urban climate, etc. And also for multi-scale, as I mentioned it, and also multi-variable for different type of parameters, and also different type of platform from radar, wind profiler, ground-based, etc. And of course, communication and real or near real time access to such data are extremely important for success of such modeling and forecasting systems. And of course, requirements from modeling community to measurements and instruments are extremely important. And here, for example, you can see some requirements for a new type of aerosol observations, which are important for integrated atmospheric couplet chemistry and meteorology models. And here just a few examples of improvement of models for using data simulation by our colleagues from US, and also Mark Pogorsky. He will give lecture one of the next day, so I suppose he will say more about this improvement of air quality forecasting by data simulation in couplet models. sorry. Other type of improvements in modeling system and also actively developing in last years using ensemble approach. And it's includes different types of ensemble, and first of all, using one models, but with different inputs, and multiple models approach, where different types of models can build ensemble, and usually ensemble approach always improve quality of models instead of different methods for ensembles are realizing, and in particular Monte Carlo simulations and ensemble calibrated for uncertainty estimations and bicycle data simulation, and also ensemble forecast analysis. And here you can see some example of improvements by ensemble approach for ozone forecast. Other type of improvements nowadays operational forecast models usually used for several days or for 1 week forecast. Modeling approach moving more and more to also subseasonal and seasonal forecast, and of course other type of improvements it's required, and also it's a research topic which is actively developed but more on research phase, and for example, the BMO has a special project for from subseasonal to seasonal forecast for weather, and also moving to air quality forecast. But it is also very important large benefits for the society, as many markets and behaviors and management decisions in different sectors required much longer forecast than a few days or forecast for a weekly forecast. And of course, it is, for example, for agriculture is extremely important. And here you can see such seamless framework moving from forecast systems from minutes and weeks and moving to months and years, and of course for climate scale forecast, and socioeconomic benefits is enormously increasing with larger scale is good quality forecast. And of course, time for such forecast is longer term, is more expensive, and needs much more efficient computers and also improved models. Other requirements from the society is a fit for purpose approach, and not always universal models are suitable for different applications, and we need to consider not only forecast of physical parameters, for example atmospheric pollution concentrations, but we need to analyze what kind of impact and what kind of risk different pollutants are provided for different sectors, and analysis of resilience capacity to minimize this impact and make such forecasting system optimal for specific purposes. One example what in this approach for health impact is considered for integrated modeling for meteorological, chemical, and biological processes relevant for health impact, because sometimes combination of different risk factors, for example, high temperature or high humidity together with pollutants, with ozone, can provide much stronger impact on health then separately. So it is one of the way where such integration is needed for complex impact on health, different stress factors. And also growing interest for air quality prediction and services is due to, as I mentioned, its impact not only for health, but also for different sectors, and requirements for such forecast is very important, and it is one of the direction of WMO programs where impact-based forecast and fit-for-purpose approach is used. One example, what I can demonstrate how it's realized for sun and dust storm warning advisory and assessment system, where forecast of atmospheric pollution by different sources of dust provided some warnings for health, aviation, agriculture, energy, and land transport, etc. And of course, thresholds and requirements for each of these sectors are different, and they also have to be analyzed and included in such modeling systems, which was not considered in previous forecasting systems, but now it's one of the new trend in developments. Here you can see example of multi-hazard forecasting systems where impact on different elements are considered on different sectors. And as I mentioned from the beginning, capacity building and training education aspects are important in our activities, and usually, especially for developing countries, we organize a lot of training courses, and also recently, together with Jan Zahn, we edited training materials and best practice for chemical weather and air quality forecasting. And this book with about 100 authors and reviewers involved from different countries around the world. and it's quite thick, about 600 pages. But you can find a lot of good advices there, how to use and how to build new modeling systems for forecasting and assessments of air quality, and it is freely available here in this link. So, of course, this book can be used also for education in universities. Now, just to conclude, I would like to repeat some key elements of scientific advancements to improve air quality forecasting systems. We need to put main efforts and where main difficulties and uncertainties are. First of all, improvements of meteorological forecast extremely important for air quality forecasting, because meteorology is the main forces of atmospheric pollution transport and also transformation. And this a key element, of course, improvement of chemical inputs, and especially for multi-scale boundary conditions should be provided not only for meteorology, but also for chemical compounds, and also with vertical structure, which is extremely important for within the planetary boundary layer, where Professor Zelitinkiewicz improved a lot of parameterizations and theory for this type of models. And of course, improvement of physical, dynamical, and chemical treatments. I'm not touching here chemistry, transport, chemical modeling in this lecture, because I know that there are special lectures and they will consider, but I just would like to stress what not only gas phase chemistry representation, but also heterogeneous chemistry is extremely important for modern forecasting and modeling system for air quality. They are more and more important, especially for aerosol transformation and formation of new type of aerosols. And of course, a numerical and computational technique to improve air quality forecasting system is extremely important. And just repeating what initial conditions are important to improve emissions and boundary conditions and model parameters, and also ensemble forecasting, as we already discussed. And other type of techniques like data fusion methods and combination of bias correction and with machine learning approaches. And finally, just some summary and perspectives for future. I just would like to stress again what quality forecast and assessment systems help decision makers to improve quality and public health and mitigate the occurrence of acute pollution episodes, in particular for urban areas, and also reduce the associated impact on for different sectors, for agriculture, ecosystems, and also for climate. And future improvements of air quality forecasting systems will follow in the following directions. First of all, as I mentioned, online coupling of atmospheric dynamic and chemistry with feedbacks, and better representation of aerosol processes is one of the key elements, and also data simulation, moving towards Earth system modeling approach, multi-scale prediction approach, and sub-seasonal to seasonal forecast, and impact-based forecast and fit-for-purpose systems. So these main conclusions, and for seamless, we'll talk tomorrow more, and I hope that it will help for your future research and activities in choice of your topics for research and professional activities in the future. And I think it's development of modern atmospheric pollution systems is extremely important, and give a good perspective. Thank you very much for your attention. And I also listed some publications. I hope that if someone is interested in more details, I can find more specific advices. Thank you.